This is being broadcast at RCTV, so thanks to them. And Mr. Robinson, Chair, will be here late this evening if he can come at all, so he's asked me to get us started. I'm going to start our meeting the way we usually do, with public comment for items not on the agenda. So did anyone come here tonight to make a public comment for an item not on the agenda?
I actually do want, that's not a public comment, but...
You come later in the agenda.
Before we begin, I want to introduce Mario Cutone, who's our new student rep. Mario, I don't know if you just want to say two brief words about yourself, or maybe a little bit more.
Well, I'm a sophomore at the high school, and I went to Coolidge Middle School, so...
That's good.
So Mario is an upcoming junior,
yes.
And Alex will be an upcoming senior. So we'll see Mario for the next 2 years, it sounds like.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Doherty. So seeing no public comment, I'm going to move to the consent agenda. Is there anything on the consent agenda that anyone on the committee would like to pull? No. All right, the consent agenda includes two Reading Memorial High School field trips, the grade 5 Camp Borndale field trip, a very generous, very, very generous donation to the Killam School, and approval of our open session minutes from May 9th. Do I have a motion?
Move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second. All those, we're not discussing consent. All those in favor? Good, 5-0. We're going to remove reports to later because we have so many staff here this evening and we want to respect your time, so we'll do reports a little later. So with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Doherty. I'm very excited to hear about some amazing educators this evening.
Thank you very much. This is always a meeting that I look forward to, and I know you look forward to every year, because we are recognizing staff for reaching particular milestones in their career. Some of the teachers and administrators and other staff members who are here this evening are at the beginning of their career and have been awarded PTS this evening, professional teaching status, for successfully completing 3 years in the Reading Public Schools as a teacher. Some are here because they've reached the 10-year milestone, others are here for 20 or 30, and some are retiring, and we're recognizing them also. So what we're going to do is I'm going to call up one school at a time. I'm going to have the building principal introduce the staff members. Some could not make it tonight, but they will also recognize those staff as well. I want to thank Michaela Saunders for doing all the legwork behind the scenes, for putting together the awards and the list that you see in front of you in your packet. So we're going to start first with the Barros Elementary School and Principal Heather Leonard.
Good evening, school committee, and Dr. Doherty, and everybody that is here, some of our fellow educators. I'm so honored to be here tonight as the principal of Barros Elementary School, and I've had the pleasure over the last week, I've spent a great deal of time over the last week just sitting with teachers and having a chance to reflect on our year, process what things went well, what challenges we had, and also looking to the future. And it was so exciting to have what felt like a luxury to just sit and talk with these amazing educators. And they do a really bad job of celebrating themselves. One of them actually said today, and acknowledged that often when there's successes, it is celebrated the students, how hard they worked, how amazing they did. And then when there's challenges, they own it. And it's something that I think a chance to celebrate their successes and the contributions they've made to all of our students in our community. It's really nice to have that happening this evening. So, I have a group of educators that are here with me this evening. I'd like to celebrate Deborah Forstel, who is one of our kindergarten teachers here at Barros. She has achieved her professional status in year 3 as one of our kindergarten teachers. So, we also have with us, Mary McGrath. Mary McGrath has received her 10 years here in the Reading District, and she's one of our fabulous first grade teachers at Barros. Also celebrating her 10-year milestone, but not here with us this evening, is Carol Cassavant, who's one of our Special Education Learning Center teachers. So congratulations to Carol on her decade of service. Reaching 20-year milestones, we have another one of our kindergarten teachers, Nancy Walcott, and celebrating 2 decades of service for Reading public students, so thank you. And also celebrating 20 years of service is Kelly Papa, who is one of our library media specialist teachers at Arizona. And a bittersweet celebration, because something that seeing somebody go is never an easy thing. Our fabulous reading specialist, Deb Burchill, is celebrating her retirement that will take place in October, so early in the fall of next year, but we wish Deb the best in her retirement and appreciate all of her service and dedication to the students of Reading. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're going to now have Eric Sprung from Joshua Eaton presentation. Yeah. Thank you very much.
So we have a number of staff members that we get to honor, and it's certainly been a very successful year at Joshua Eaton. It's been a real pleasure for me to get to know staff and see all the wonderful work that's happening there, and certainly the staff that have been there for a number of years, for 10 and 20 years, have really set a strong, positive culture and environment that I feel good about being a part of. So the staff that couldn't be here have been part of the school and district for 10 years are Liz McGivna and Judy Cooper. They would be receiving their 10-year pins, which I will present to them. And it is a pleasure to say that Maureen Lynch has been here for 20 years, which is going to be great to present a pin for her. And Jamie, who has been part of the district for 10 years. I'm also very excited to talk about Jamie, because Jamie is on a path for leadership. And so she is working on her administrative degree. So we always like to see our part of our school system who's going to continue to be leaders in our district. So congratulations.
Thank you.
To
you. Thank you.
And so Jane Merrill couldn't be here today, but I'm going to be presenting Jane Merrill with her retirement gift. So we are certainly going to miss Jane. And we always say to our retirees, they're always welcome to come back and visit us. And Jane lives close, so we know that she'll be back visiting us at Joshua. Congratulations to Jake.
Thank you. We're going to have Birch Meadow next, and Patty Beckman is going to join Eric. Patty, come on.
So first of all, thank you so much for letting me be here and show off my incredible staff. I've had a unique opportunity this year to take part in and have a different perspective on the people that I work with every day, and it's been a joy. They are just amazing. So here's just a sampling of our amazing teachers that are celebrating milestones tonight. We have Anna Gervinas, who is our dedicated school psychologist. She tirelessly addresses the social, emotional, and behavioral needs of our students every day. She is just making a real difference in the lives of our students, and I'm really excited to present her with her professional teaching status tonight. So we have Beth Slater. Beth Slater has been at Birch Meadow now for 10 years, and she's been teaching our fifth graders and getting them well prepared for their next journey into middle school. And so we're excited that she's here, and we appreciate all the great things that she does for our fifth graders. Congratulations on receiving your 10-year pin. That are getting their 10-year pin, Peg McDermott. Peg helps to make our school run smoothly, whether it's in creating things or printing things, or in so many ways she supports our students and our staff members, fixing things. She's just an all-around wonderful person, the smiling face that greets our students and our families every morning. So thank you, Peg. We appreciate your dedication to our students and our staff. Congratulations on 10 years. also celebrating 10 years with us. She's been an essential member of our DLC staff, really supporting the students and the staff and encouraging the students under her care. So she's extremely patient and flexible and dedicated, and we want to congratulate her on 10 years of service. And we do have, again, bittersweet, we have actually two retirements this year. Janice Garrity is with us. Janice has been an outstanding educator for 43 years.
Wow.
We're very fortunate to have her. If your children or you or other people, neighbors, were privileged to have her as a teacher, you would have heard her many wonderful stories about Joshua Eaton and about Perch Meadow. She's taught first, second, and third grade in all those years. And we definitely will miss her in the halls of Birch Meadow. So congratulations, we wish you all the best. We do also have another retirement. We have Rick Downs, and he again was with us for 43 years teaching the children of Reading. We often have the students come back, the parents come back, and neighbors and friends and grandparents, and I think he might be one teacher that each year is recognized by a student that's receiving their National Honor Society. One of the very few elementary school teachers that has that great honor. So again, his calm and funny and endearing way will be missed in the halls of Birch Meadow. So we want him to have a wonderful time with his retirement. We wish him the best as well. No one can fill his shoes, but I'm sure he's gonna be pleased when he gets his little gift. So we'll present him with that tomorrow. Thank you so much for having us here, and thank you to my staff.
I'd like to have Kathy Giles, principal at Killam.
They're telling me to keep it short.
Hi, everyone. Killam is a terrific place because of our staff, and we have four people here tonight, but we actually, I have it here on my phone, we actually have more to recognize. I probably can't read this machine, so I have to blow it up. I don't know what's happening. I'm just getting old, I guess, right? So Victoria LeBlanc is being recognized tonight for 10 years. And Victoria not only is one of our terrific kindergarten paras, but she has given her heart and soul into changing the way our dining hall operates, our kids' cafe, and she's really took the lead on that and transformed not only the way we do things, but also the way our kiddos behave during the lunch period. So thank you, Victoria. And Lauren Araki is not here. She's currently a fourth grade teacher, and she is also being recognized for her 10 years of service. This year, Lauren is the fourth grade teacher who's been piloting the No Adam curriculum, and it's just a wonderful thing to see, and her students are so engaged in there in the classrooms, and she's doing fabulous things with technology. So thank you for approving that very generous donation. We're looking forward to getting more technology for next year. What did you say?
No, they did approve it.
I said thank you. Joellen, 20 years you have been a teacher at Killam School, and I first met Joellen as a Killam staff member when I took my tour, when I was touring as a candidate 9 years ago. And you were just so welcoming and so supportive, and you have been there for me all along and for our students. So thank you so much. Priscilla, and I've worked at Killam, but when Paul Garrett was retiring, he said to me, listen, you're lucky. You'll have her for 1 year, and then she's going to retire. She's going to train you and retire. And it's 9 years later. So, Priscilla, thank you so much. She truly is the eyes, the ears, and the know-all of Killam School. People ask me a question, and I'll say, hold on 1 minute, and I'll put the phone down, and I'll go out and I'll ask Pete, and she knows it all. So, thank you. I have Ms. Caffrey, Megan Caffrey. She is being recognized tonight for her professional status. And Megan is a girl that I go to whenever I need some data imported into Google Docs. I'll say, can you do this for me? And she'll do it, right? Part of your professional goal this year. So I'm proud to present you with your achievement and your professional status. I also have, let me see here, I have Allie Burns, who is being recognized, and she's actually going to be working over at Joshua Eaton next year, so we're so happy we can keep her in the district. She started there, actually, as a student teacher, so she says she's going home. I have Alice Gomez, our school psychologist, who's actually doing her practicum tonight, so she's not here with us. Lauren Gramolini is one of our fourth grade teachers, and she actually started over at Barrow years ago. And Holly Gallant is our music teacher, and so be sure to give thanks to all of them. Did I forget something? Lawrence Pinn. Okay, I think I have everybody. Thank you all, and thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, would like to have now the Rise Preschool. Debbie Butts.
This is Janelle. thank you all for doing this lovely celebration. It really is nice to recognize you. We don't do it often enough. Janelle Booten has been in the Reading Public Schools 10 years. At least three at Rice. I tried to figure out exactly what her history was, and it's a little shady, I don't even know. She's been around. She's one of the most creative, musical preschool teachers around. And I've invited you all lots of times. Please come and visit us, and we'll see what wonderful things you do. But I want to recognize her here. This is it? There you go. And Kelly Berry, who's a speech and language pathologist, couldn't be here tonight. She's also celebrating 10 years at the Rise Preschool. So thank you very much, and have a great evening.
Okay, let's go next to Coolidge Middle School. Principal Sarah Marchant.
I have one representative who's representing everybody. But I will start with Sydney tonight. Again, reiterating what everyone else has said, thank you so much for having us tonight. And it's wonderful to take pause and celebrate teachers and their milestones. And I would like to start with Cindy Barbera, who joined Coolidge 3 years ago. And it's kind of funny that we're calling her a professional teacher now after 3 years, because when she arrived, she was all that and more, and she just immersed herself right into Coolidge. And the students have absolutely thrived in her Spanish classroom in the seventh and eighth grade. And she immersed herself into our professional culture, and just seemed like she was right part of Coolidge culture right from day one. So what was kind of funny, and I'll tell you a story, I got her certificate in the inter-office mail, and I signed it. I was like, I'm going to go down and give this to her right now. And we had a little celebration in her classroom, and the kids cheered, and we did
the drum roll. Very efficient.
And then, yeah, very efficient, and it was very fun. And then about a week later, I said, Cindy, can you still have that certificate? And I had to ask for it back. And so here it is again. So who could not be here here tonight, we have Dina Kenny, who's celebrating her 10 years at Coolidge. She's a Learning Center para educator, and she has been steadfast in her dedication to our students in the Learning Center. Jim Henneberry is also celebrating his 10th year, and he teaches 6th grade ELA and couldn't be here tonight. And Ann Jacobsmeyer, celebrating 20 years. So any of you who know Ann and her commitment to our 6th grade social studies curriculum and energy is renowned for sure, and they will all be missed tonight. And a big milestone for anyone who's ever entered Coolidge in the evening hours or afternoon, you know Rafael Mercado, who is retiring this year.
Oh.
And I know it's a familiar face for Coolidge and a beloved custodian, and he will certainly be missed. And I look forward to giving them their pins and their honors, and we'll speak on their behalf when I see them in person. So thank you again for having us.
Thank you, Sarah. We're going to have Assistant Principal Mike McSweeney now give some recognition to the high school staff.
Can I have the PTS teachers come up first, please? It is an honor to be here tonight representing the administration of RMHS to recognize some teachers on some really important milestones that we're very proud of. This first group of teachers is a group that of course we're very proud of, who have in their first 3 years really impressed us with their energy and their enthusiasm and commitment and know-how. They're people who have lent their voices to important discussions in the school right off the bat, and that's something we've really appreciated, and they're people we're very excited about working with going into the future. And so I present to you tonight from the Special Education Department, Sarah Cummings. From the Special Education Sarah Cummings. From the Foreign Language Department, Ms. Casey Greer. Our Head of Guidance, Ms. Lynn Williams. From the Math Department, Ms. Kylie Kane. I should mention as well that social studies teacher Jessica Bailey is also part of this PTS group, as is foreign language teacher Tanya McSorley. When I looked at this list earlier today, I thought, boy, we did really well 10 years ago. quite a group of teachers who have hit that 10-year milestone. And so I asked them to come forward now, please. Here tonight with us are Carolyn Allison from the Social Studies Department. Ms. Kate Crosby from the English Department. And Ms. Morgan from the English Department. Also, having just finished their 10th year at Reading High, our athletic trainer Erica Sanchez, guidance counselor Sarah Munier, art teacher Kathy Daly, science teacher Jennifer Thomas, art teacher Veronique Latimer, foreign language teacher Danya Mahoney, a paraeducator Colleen DiMattei, guidance counselor Stephen Kennedy. And that's it actually for the 10 year folks. So now on to folks who are here with us tonight celebrating their 20-year milestone. First, over to my right, we have a teacher from the Special Education Department who I consider just an outstanding advocate for the students that she serves. The students who are on her caseload get 100% from this teacher every year, and other students in who receive special education services benefit from her voice working on their behalf as she advocates to the whole faculty and reminds us often of the fact that there's more than one way to teach something, and students have many needs that can be served in many ways. So over the years, she's someone I've really valued as providing that voice and that advocacy, and that is Ms. Jeannie Thomas. Also reaching the 20-year milestone and here with us tonight is a gentleman who shares every day his passion for and knowledge of history with students at RMHS. His time. He has also, if some folks here may not know, worked with students at Parker Middle School as well. So he has worked with students at the middle school level and the high school level. We're very fortunate as well to have him as our football coach. He works with kids in so many ways and offers so much of himself to kids. Just recently, he was recognized by a student at the National Honor Society induction for the work he's done with that student, the way he's influenced that student and guided that student in a way that student will never forget. And I know he's done that for many, many students. So thank you, John Fury. Gentleman who's not with us tonight but has reached a 20-year milestone is Mr. Gary Dentremont, also of the Social Studies Department. Mr. Maurice Hillis of the Facilities Department has served, has worked in the Reading Public Schools for 30 years. He hit his 30-year milestone this year. And that leaves us with one retiree. And this is a teacher from our science department, Ms. Noreen Scarpito. And Noreen, in her time at Reading Memorial High School, has worked with kids as a coach, as a class advisor, and has been a mentor to so many kids. She is a top-notch instructor, a real professional, and someone who is not easily replaced at all. So we're really going to miss her at the high school, and we wish her well in her retirement.
So I have the honor of presenting the Parker, and I believe it's on three. Oh, there's three. Okay. So first, I'm going to start with the PTS, Special Education Teacher Marty. Congratulations. Other teachers that received PTS but couldn't be here this evening includes Jess Brehout, who's a social studies teacher at Parker. We also have some 10-year PIN recipients, Renee Jellin and Jennifer Webster, who could not be here this evening. And a 20-year recipient, Vonda Gauthier. And now I'm down to the last two. And first, you get a double tonight. Which is really great, because I can't see the 30. Sorry, I don't have my glasses on. There it is, thank you. Should have brought my glasses up with me. So I would like to present both a 30-year pin and a retiree pin to Chris Copeland. I've had the pleasure of working with Chris for the time I've been here, a long time, in a variety of roles when I was a teacher, then when I was principal, assistant superintendent, and now in her role as RTA president. So we've worked together for a long time, so I wish you the best of luck. Congratulations. And we have another retiree who was someone else that I've worked with for a long time. In fact, I believe I had your children at Coolidge when I was a teacher. And that is Ann Natale, who has been a sixth grade math teacher for many years at Parker, but also has been instrumental at the state level with MCAS and with standards-based education for math at the state level and in the curriculum framework. So, Anne, thank you very much for everything you've done. And we have Woodend, we have two teachers from Woodend who are getting recognized tonight, but we're not able to make it. Lindsay Tanish, who is receiving her 10-year pin, and Carrie DiNapoli, who is receiving PTS. So congratulations to them as well.
I would just like to take this opportunity to, on behalf of the Reading School Committee and the entire Reading community, to express our deepest gratitude. The work that you do every day does not go unnoticed by this community. You know, you could have chosen to do anything with your lives, and you chose this. So for that, we say thank you. And for those of you who are retiring, good job, good luck. We wish you a long and healthy and happy retirement. Thank you for all that you've done for our kids. Recess?
Sure.
All right, we're going to take just a 2-minute recess to let people leave the room. Up next on our agenda, I think Dr. Doherty and some others are going to lead us through a discussion of the recent water testing here in town. Dr. Doherty.
Thank you. So in light of what happened last week, I thought it would be important to put this on the agenda item. I do have here with me this evening Director of Finance, Director of Facilities Joe Huggins, and I have Kevin Gerstner, who is the custodial supervisor for the schools. I also have from the Town Water Department Peter Isbell and Eric Mislekwi. And then from the NWRA, Stephen Estes Smargassi. Did I say that right? Okay, great. Before I turn it over to them, I just want to give some brief comments and give a little bit of insight of what's happened over the last week. First of all, we've met several times both before this issue came about and during this issue's come out. This has been another example of a town and school departments working together. I met with, Joe and I met with Eric a few months ago after the Flint water situation to talk about what we've been doing and what we're gonna be doing in the future. At that point, we decided, the Town Water Department took the lead, that we were going to follow the recommendations of the EPA and the MWRA, which was to do more aggressive water testing as opposed to the way that the testing had been done in the past as required. And they can go into more detail on the type of water testing that was done pre-Flint, Michigan, and then when the new recommendations came out, what we've been doing since. And so, we did the testing with the new recommendations, which was essentially to do in every school a series of samples. So all of our schools, I believe we did 13 to 15 water samples a few weeks ago. And we, on Wednesday night, we heard the results of those samples. And as I mentioned to you and to the community in an email the next morning, we received word that the Killam Elementary School had 7 readings out of the 13 that were above the recommended levels of 15 parts per billion. Birch Meadow had 1 out of the 15 recommended readings that was over the level, and Coolidge had 1 as well. So as soon as we found out that information, we met. As you remember, we had that evening the town listening session, so we met after that town listening session to develop our plan, which we enacted that next morning, which was to shut down all of the drinking water fountains at the Killam Elementary School, to take offline the drinking fountains at the Birch Meadow that had the recommended level, and to also take offline, to make a hand washing station only the Coolidge reading, which was in the kitchen. We then brought in water for Killam, so we shut down all of the drinking fountains at Killam, and we brought in water. We had water stations set up. Our facilities department handled that. I met with staff, and Principal Kathy Giles and I met with staff that morning to educate them on what was going on. We notified the Killam community and then the entire community that morning as soon as we knew what was going on. And then on Friday, the water department did additional testing on Killam. So now all of the faucets, all of the faucets and drinking fountains have been tested. It takes about 2 weeks for us to get those tests. So once we get those results, we'll determine the next course of action. And they will get into more detail on that. At Birch Meadow, we will be doing water testing on all of the fountains and water faucets this week. And again, they'll go into more detail on that. And at Coolidge on Friday, we also, I believe, did the testing of all of the kitchen because that's where the source was of the above level reading. I should mention also that at Killam also, because we had a reading in the kitchen, We shut the kitchen down, so the kitchen could only be used for dishwashing purposes and hand washing purposes. And the cooking for the food is being done off-site at the high school and then brought over for anything that requires boiling or cooking with water. So that's a summary of where we are right now, and then I'm going to turn it over, I think, to Eric, right?
Yes, correct.
And Eric's going to take it from here and talk a little bit more in detail on what's been going on.
Thank you, John. On a regular basis with the lead contamination, lead and copper rule, we would test, the rule states that you'd test two schools and two sources in each school, and that was the how the schools got tested for lead and copper. So as a town would or a water system would come up for its required lead and copper testing, the Massachusetts own is one of the few states that allows makes you test your schools as well, which is nice. But again, it's just two sources and two schools. So my predecessor, Peter Tassi, set up a really good testing program. We always tested more than two schools. We tested sometimes four or six schools. So testing results go all the way back to 1993. As we move forward, you have no violations of the action level. You're for the first 6 months of your water testing in two cycles, then it switches over that you do annual testing. So then we became an annual town, which did annual testing for lead and copper. Then if you did that with no violations for 3 years, you'd switch over to triennial testing. So you'd test once every 3 years. So in that whole cycle, we would again test the schools. In this year, with a lot of the things that have happened with Flint, Michigan, the EPA pressed on states to heavily suggest that wasn't enough testing, that we should move forward. And the EPA has a Lead Contamination Control Act, which is the LCCA rule. So that's kind of sits next to your lead and copper rule that for a regular water system. The LCCA suggests, if you were to follow their recommendation, you'd take your full school, you'd map it out, which Kevin did, and you'd isolate and number each fixture, whether it's a bubbler or a faucet, so it has its own unique identification number. Then you'd, in a three-year cycle, you would test one-third of all the faucets 1 year, one-third of all the faucets next year, and the third year you'd test the last third. And then you, the way the law stands now is you'd file every 5 years. So you're kind of in that sequence. So every time you'd file, you would have gone through a sequence where you've tested all the fixtures. Although we were very aggressive in our testing anyways in the past, not every fixture was tested in every school. So this is sometimes the first time that some of these fixtures had been tested. And it was we scored very well across the board on, you know, we have eight schools, very minimal violations, except in Killam there was some that brought awareness to us that we wanted to go back and retest. So instead of waiting the next 3 years to do the other third, we just decided that we should test all the fixtures in Killam because it was at that level. So we came back in and we tested all the fixtures. This time, not only we do a first draw sample, so your first samples need to sit in the pipes for 6 to 8 hours prior, so it gives you a full saturation of what the water would be like. Mm-hmm. So we did that, as well as we did a 30-second flush sample. So what that really does is this second round of testing will allow us to isolate whether it's the fixture or whether it's the plumbing in the walls, and that can kind of establish the course of action to resolve the matter. So that's the process that we did.
So the plan will be that the next step is going to be, once we get the results back, that our focus will be on the kitchen, to get the kitchen back up online so that they can, Kristen's staff can cook in there in the fall. We've got 3 weeks left right now, so we're going to continue on the course we've been on right now, get the results back, examine them, see where the source is, and then we'll make a decision as to whether or not it's going to be new main runs to the fixtures or new fixtures in the kitchen. and then we'll look at the school, we'll have another meeting and talk about the remaining fixtures in the building, how we handle that.
Depending on what the tests determine, are gonna depend on what the course of action is gonna be. So for example, if the tests come out that the source is right at the faucet, it may be as simple as replacing the faucet. However, if it shows that the testing is showing that it's in the pipes, now we've got a different issue that we've got to figure out how to solve. So those are questions we don't have answered yet. And so when we get this additional round of testing in a couple of weeks, we'll know better. As Joe said, we're gonna supply bottled water for the rest of this school year, and then we'll take a look and see what needs to happen during the summer. One option, if it is an issue with the pipes, and we may have to not, and we may not be able to replace every pipe in the school, is that we provide water bubblers, like portable water bubblers, at different stations throughout the school where you would normally have a water drinking fountain, and you shut down all the drinking water fountains. That's certainly going to have a cost to it. Probably somewhere around $10,000 to $15,000 for the year. That includes electrical cost. We have to keep the water cold, things like that. So those are things we're still looking into, but we definitely have a course of action for different options depending on what the tests are going to show. I don't know if Stephen, you wanted to say anything from your perspective.
Maybe a step back for those who, I think, because we sort of leaped into the middle. This is not a water problem. It's essentially a plumbing problem. The water that you receive from the Quabbin Reservoir, as it passes from the reservoir all the way through all of MWRA's pipes, the community's pipes, is lead-free when it gets to the street outside. The problem is that water is that universal solvent. It wants to dissolve metals, wants to dissolve all sorts of things, but in particular, lead is something it would really like to dissolve. We adjust the water chemistry to make it much less likely. Lead levels in the region have dropped by about 90% since we started doing corrosion control back in 1996. But if the water sits stagnant long enough in contact with material with lead, and that could be a bit of brass, some lead solder. Lead solder was allowed up until 1986. Nationwide, up until 2014, brass could contain up to 8% lead. Here in Massachusetts, we had stricter standards. It was supposed to only be 3%, but it still had some lead in it. So if a bit of water happens to be sitting in contact with one of those brass fittings or something in a water cooler, it can pick up some lead when the water's been stagnant. When the water's running past those at a reasonable rate of flow, it's not gonna pick up any lead. The same thing is true in any one of our homes. Our faucets, elbows, fittings on the copper piping can all pick up lead if the water sits stagnant long enough. So I guess I'd say one other thing, which is I got a call Wednesday night at about, I don't know, maybe 9:30 or so with a group of folks obviously on the other end of the phone, and spent an hour talking with your team on this. Was impressed by, one, the fact that we delivered the results that afternoon and folks were working on it that night, that there was a plan to understand the issue. I got a lot of hard questions, then communicate and take action immediately the next day. This is, you know, in dealing with my peers around the country, it's the kind of thing we like to see when a community gets results. Understand them, act on them, communicate them, and then proceed from there. Some folks like to try and understand the whole thing. Don't tell anybody, let me see if I can fix this, and then I'll tell you what I did. The strategy the town's taken is a good, cautious one. Take action quickly, communicate quickly, and then proceed from there.
That's great feedback. Thank you for that. Were there any more presentations? Or
no, I think that was...
The committee has some questions. Mrs. Webb?
So I would like to build on that, and then I had a specific question. So I just want to say how impressed I was, because John and many school committee members and staff were at the community listening session on Wednesday night, so they couldn't call you till 9:30 because they were listening about some very important topics. And as a school committee member, I think by 6:30 in the morning, I had in my email maybe two or three versions of the letters that would need to go out to the community. And all of these meetings had already happened. And, you know, so there was the letter that was going to go to the Killam community, the broader community, and we're getting a press release ready, and we've taken these corrective actions. I mean, it was definitely high quality for 8D, you know, quality process improvement. I was so impressed, I got it at work, and I'm in my work mode, and I'm like, wow, like, this is just amazing. And at the same time, I sit here and I go, oh my gosh, we're gonna get all these calls because people are gonna flip out. But it's much better to have taken this route than to sort of, oh wait, let's wait and figure it out. But I wanna commend John and all of his staff, because to do that between, you know, the afternoon and 9:30 at night, because you couldn't even start on it till 9:30 at night, and have it done by 6:30 in the morning is amazing. It's a tribute to the creativity, the level of resource that gets tapped into in our community, the schools and the town. And I think it's so important that we step up so that we can continue to deliver this kind of really amazing service. And this is about protecting our kids. Every day, it's about educating our kids. Protecting is always the thing we say we do without even talking about it. In this case, this is where it was first and foremost and paramount, and I was personally blown away by that. So I wanted to say thank you to everybody, and obviously you were working later than you thought, too. A question about the MWRI, you said with confidence that you know that the water that's delivered is lead-free to our homes, to the schools, and the water mains, MWRA. So are there test points that are routinely tested? Is that maybe you could just comment?
So there's two types of testing we do. One type of testing tests that the treatment process that we have in place, which is adjusting the pH and the alkalinity of the water so we have a stable, non-corrosive water. Mm-hmm. We test that every day at the treatment plant. We have operating band that needs to stay in. That's tested daily. That data, by the way, is up on our website. Then we test across the entire region periodically. We have a different set of standards for that stable water quality across the entire region. And then once a year, across the entire region, all the cities and towns collect data in homes, and not just any home, but homes which are at higher risk for having lead, so it has to have a lead service line, or it has to be a home which was built or replumbed just at the very end of when lead solder was allowed, so it has sort of the freshest old lead solder in the plumbing. And then we test that water, the homeowner tests the water, after it's sat stagnant overnight. So it's sort of like three levels of, mm-hmm. if there's going to be lead in the water, this is a place and this is a time where we would find it. And we have to take all those results and compare them to a standard. We have to have a 90th percentile, 99 out of 10 results need to be below what they call the action level for lead. So that's a process that goes on every time, every year on a regular basis. Reading does a similar process. Because you guys had your own source up until recently, the town's continued with their own local testing program. But we do all the testing on the chemistry. The town does the same type of testing on high-risk homes. And by the way, all that data is available on our website. And one other thing I'd say is that given all the questions we've had this year, based on the debacle, and there's no other word for it, mm-hmm. tragedy in Flint, our annual water quality report, which is in the mail as I speak, the first ones were delivered a couple days ago, has significantly more information on lead this year than usual. We actually did expanded the length of the report by a couple pages and added a lot more information on lead because we know that people have a lot of questions. So you'll be seeing that sometime in the next few weeks. They were delivered to my office about an hour and a half ago. So it'll look like this, and it's got a lot of information on lead. So the town will probably get some questions. We anticipate questions, but we tried to answer a lot of that in the material we send out every year.
Mrs. Joyce.
A question kind of about the process. I understand now it seems like the timing of when we're testing is going to change. It's going to be a little bit more elevated. But is the actual process of the testing that we've just done that found these levels, was this the exact same test that have been done in previous years?
The differences in all previous years, the two fixtures in the school were tested. So it was this was a full test of all the fixtures in the schools. So it was the same process, except now we're expanded to test, you know, 15 of the 45 fixtures in the school versus two fixtures in the school, which was the previous law. It's two laws side by side. The lead and copper rule is you know, for homes and for, you know, two sources and two schools. Next to that is a second law, which is an EPA law, which is a state recommendation. So it's not, we're not bound to, we weren't bound to test one third of the fixtures in the schools, but it was a strong suggestion, both from the state and from the MWRA to do so. So that's why we did that.
And you did that. So you did a third as opposed to just say two in each school.
Yeah. What we did is exactly. Okay. We Kevin from facilities, he and I worked together. Kevin mapped it out. He structured it and just said, all right, we have, you know, six faucets here in the classroom, so we're going to do, you know, two of those. We have 16 fountains, we're going to do five of those or something of that nature. And then that became our testing list. And he set it up so that an even portion of classroom sinks, an even portion of bubblers would all be tested. Once we do that, we've kind of thought we were going to be okay, actually. But then once we did that, we saw that we did have a problem in Killam, which is, it's kind of, you know, throwing out a big fishing net and dragging it in and really looking at it. And then we went back and then we did the full test of every single fixture in the whole school, which is, it was 68 fixtures in Killam that offer water, both as a bubbler and a faucet.
And then I just want to understand Birch Meadow, because you said you're doing testing there now and the results come back.
We decided, even though there was only one location at Birch Meadow, that we would also test those. So that's going to be happening this week.
That's correct.
And you're testing all of them?
Yep. Yeah, okay. What we did, yep.
So given the fact that you're testing them now and it takes 2 weeks, did you consider doing water for the students at Birch Meadow too, just as a precaution? Because it's, you know, we're in the last couple of weeks of school, it's a little bit warmer, or you don't think that that's...
We did not, I mean, basically, because there was 15 samples done, there was only one that did not reach the level, we did not.
And it wasn't even that the other ones were just below the level, they were just not, there was
not
no
there.
Water, no lead in the water at all.
Great.
And if you, we did, there was quite a few requests to have that data put forth, and so we did upload that to the water department website.
It's in your packet.
It's right online.
Yeah, I saw that. Yes.
Yeah, and it's and you can look through there and see that there's, you know, that we highlighted exactly what was over. Most of the sources are going to be from the fixture. So if a sink was you know, a 1950s sink, and it hardly gets used just because the nature of the school, you know, water bubbles get used, water bubbles get replaced. Every water bubble is checked. So it's mostly like an old sink that's in the principal, the worst one of all was in the principal's, you know, bathroom.
Right,
you know?
Yeah.
But if you think about it, how many gallons of water come out of that a year? Not a lot, you know, and how many times has it been turned on and turned off? And so it's really, once we were able to look at the whole picture, we can really isolate that particular fixture. So that particular fixture at Birch Meadow was taken offline.
Yeah.
It's just not used. And, you know, we felt very comfortable that the rest of the water is very safe with no or low levels.
Okay.
with lead in the water.
Great, thank you.
Yes.
Can I just clarify? So the testing that you did you say you took the two types of samples, basically the stagnant and then the 32nd?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, and we would do that the MWRA suggested to do that, and it's really a nice way to ascertain whether it's the actual fixture or whether it's the water in the system.
Okay, so if we see a high result in that fixture, then we'll analyze the second sample and say it's more likely this or it's possibly something further up the pipe.
I just learned that I'm going to let the water run in my slop sink before I fill my water bottle on the way out the door. Good morning.
And again, it's not a, it's, you know, it sounds like we're underlining and highlighting. It's not a water issue. It's a building issue or a home issue. The water is really a high quality water. We have a really strict testing program that we test ourselves, and we always have gone over and above. And, you know, this is why it came to our attention so quickly, is from that, you know, being able to test all that.
Mm-hmm.
I have a question for clarification. So this this additional testing was all driven by EPA guidelines changing. Is your perception that those changes are permanent? Moving forward, we will continue to test at this higher level?
I think I defer to Stephen on that particular question.
So the federal law, which is called the Lead Contamination Control Act, or LCCA, it's a strange beast. It's essentially a set of guidance from the federal government. It's all voluntary. It had sort of some ideas on what they recommended for testing, and if you boil it down, their thought process was that you would try and make sure that you were testing in a building at least periodically, some fraction of the faucets, perhaps one third every year if you wanted to be the sort of most thorough. Different communities are sort of looking at it differently. If you've got a building where you've never seen any lead, they may be looking at that less frequently. If you've got a building where you've seen maybe middling levels, not necessarily elevated, not enough to take immediate action, but something that could be potentially, if it were a little higher, a problem, they might be testing that a little more frequently. So that's something that I think around the state, a lot of folks are trying to get their arms around, thinking about how do you set up a long-term program that's both effective at assuring that you understand water quality, but also, you know, efficient from a resource perspective. Sampling, if you've got a building with all brand new plumbing and all brand new fixtures and you don't find any lead repeatedly, you're probably not going to find any lead afterward, later, so maybe you sample there less frequently. So that's something the town, not just Reading, but all the communities are going to have to get their arms around, how to come up with a useful program.
That comment, actually your last comment leads to my next question. It seems to me from reading the paper, other communities are dealing with this. Reading is not the only town that has found this in some schools. Is that accurate? Can you give me the context of how this is playing out across the state?
Yeah, Wilmington has you know, four different schools with four different bubblers that have the same issue. You know, so it's more of that, you know, those conditions exist, and now we've kind of gone and like kind of brought the rake in and kind of sorted through everything. So it's not just common to Reading. It's more of the Northeast, I'd say.
Okay. So it's nationwide.
Yeah. Well, it speaks to why this is important. Yeah. It's a
national. I mean, it's essentially, as I said, water's a universal solvent. Brass used to contain a lot more lead, contains less now, new plumbing. So pretty much almost everyone is going to find some problem somewhere. The MWRA added some additional resources in our lab and then said to all the communities in the service area, look, your citizens are concerned about this. We've got the capability to do the testing. I've got a queue now of, I think, as of this afternoon, perhaps 18 communities that have come in and said they expect to do sampling this spring. Reading's in that, some samples at the front of the queue and some samples a little further back in the queue. We've urged basically everyone to get samples taken before the end of June. We'll try and turn around the results as quickly as we can so folks can act before school starts next fall and have, you know, an organized plan in place. What are you doing about this?
I have a quick question.
Mr. Nine.
So the product called flex tubing, is that something that is used more frequently in newer buildings, or if you're replacing things, familiar with that? Is that something that would?
Yeah, he's like a PEX. PEX. We were just discussing that. Joe would be better one to answer that question.
Yeah, we talked to our plumber, and it's not something that's approved for commercial applications, but there might be a possibility of getting a waiver.
Yeah, the DEP and the City of Boston are, I think, talking at this point to the plumbing board about whether, given this situation, whether there might be a way to think about doing drinking water fountains with non-metallic plumbing. I don't know what the status of that is, but it's a question that's been raised. Certainly new copper with brand new brass, which after January of 2014 has very, very, very low levels of lead in it, and new solder with no lead in it would also be acceptable. It's just it's more disruptive to tear open all the walls to put in new copper than it is to snake the PEX in. So folks are looking at both of those options.
Thank you.
So just along those lines, though, you'd have to test for different precipitates then, because who knows, do we know what those are for the PEX? I I mean, the PECs are, it's used in residential construction all the time now, and we're testing water for the things you expect to see, you know, for lead, the older homes, whatever. But, you know, you've now put the PECs in somewhere or new homes, so do we even know what we should be testing for?
Yeah.
So it may not be, before you take a big leap, you want to know what you're leaping into.
Yeah. That's clearly an issue. I often say in our office, there's no free lunch.
Yeah.
You need to think about whenever you substitute one thing for another,
right,
what the other issues are.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that's being looked at nationwide at this point for all the materials we look at.
I just wanted to say thank you very much for your thoroughness. Thank you for being proactive on this. And thank you also for thinking about stopgap solutions. The idea of having bubblers put in, like we might have in our homes, where you can take water from them that get us away from the fixtures attached to the plumbing. I think that's a great solution. I guess I'd just weigh in that as we figure out more of what needs to be done, whether it's the pipes in the walls or whether it's the fixtures attached to the walls, that we come back to the table in terms of long-term fixes versus Band-Aids, because Killam has been on the list for a very long time for its upgrades. And I think that if we do a lot of Band-Aids, I'm just wondering about whether that's something that the State Building Association might now help us fund, because there's an actual problem. And I know that there aren't answers now, but I just wanted to say I'd love those on the list before we start thinking about Band-Aids.
That's an excellent point.
Thank you.
I hear what you're saying. I do think we need to hear about what the next steps are.
Right.
To Dr. Doherty's point, if it's a matter of changing a faucet, you know, versus interior plumbing, I think we need to know a lot more about what we're dealing with before we go down the road, but it's a good point. Is there anything else?
That's good.
Anything else? I want to, I know Mrs. Webb already said it, but I want to reiterate the communication list was truly exemplary, so I'm very grateful for that. I know the community was as well. Not just the timeliness of it, but the thoroughness of it. You read those memos and went, okay, I understand exactly what has happened. I understand exactly what's going to happen next, and I know what, it was just very thorough and very thoughtfully done on an unbelievably tight timeline. This is obviously a really important issue for the community, so I'm going to suggest that we put an update on this on the July agenda so that we can all get an update. Maybe we'll have 2 weeks from now, we'll have more testing, just to have a better sense of where we're at and what the plan is over the summer to get us ready for school in the fall. Anything else? Thank you, gentlemen, very much for being here this evening and for all that you've done.
Another quick break while we set up for the next.
Oh, okay. We're going to have another 2 minute recess.
Thank you. So we just wanted to give you an update on our meal pricing review and where our findings were. So Reading participates in the National School Lunch Program, and we get about $215,000 a year annually for reimbursable meal sales. And the Healthy, Hungry, Free Kids Act of 2010 requires us to look at our pricing annually. And this provision requires participating districts to ensure that they're providing the same level of support for lunches served to students who are not eligible for free or reduced as they are for lunches served to students who are eligible for free and reduced. So. So Reading, we are required to charge students for paid meals at a price that is on average equal to the difference between free meal reimbursement and paid meal reimbursement. Did I say that right? Okay. I'm going to defer to my director. I should have introduced her at the start. I apologize. Krista Morello, who's the director of food services, is here with us as well this evening. And she did the heavy lifting on this. So we annually review our paid lunch revenue to assure compliance with this law. We're required to adjust our price or find an alternate source, which means we'd have to find $215,000 more of revenue, which we don't want to do. So we want to be in compliance with this law. And this year, the pricing was $2.78. And when you look at our average meal for lunches for elementary, middle, and high school, we would need to adjust by 8 cents to come into compliance for next year. So we don't have to do anything for this year. It's for next year that we're talking about. So the last time we increased our pricing was back in the 12-13 school year. We increased it by a quarter back then. So we haven't increased our prices in a number of years. Anecdotally, it was $2.65 was the equitable lunch price 2 years ago. It up to $2.70 for this year, and it's going up to $2.78 for next year. So a 25-cent increase a few years ago was good for a number of years, so we weren't upping it by a nickel or a dime here and there. So that's one of the reasons why we recommended a 25-cent increase, because it should carry us for at least a year, well, more than a year, it should carry us for 2, maybe 3 years. We were very lucky this year with the 270. We just squeaked by without having to increase it for this year. So a 25-cent increase really did carry us through for 4 years. Just to give you the landscape competitively, not that it's competitive, but just to see what other towns are charging for their lunches, you can see Burlington, Linfield, Tewksbury, Wakefield. We're all in the same neighborhood. No one is charging excessively more. They're pretty much within the guidelines of the 278.
We do seem to be on the low end, though.
Yeah.
A little bit. By about 25 cents.
So based on our current volume of participation, at a minimum, like I said, we'd have to increase it 8 cents to come in compliance for next year. As I said, one of the reasons we were recommending 25 cents is it would carry us through for a few years, but there's some other considerations as well. We do have some aging equipment at Killam and Parker and Barrows. You know, some of the steamer at Parker is from the 1960s. If that goes, it's a pretty expensive piece of equipment. Same thing at Killam. There's a few things. Their freezer is almost 40 years old. So there are some things, and this is a revolving fund that funds itself. So if something breaks, Kristen fixes it. And I know we've replaced a number of things from dishwashers and ovens as things have gone. But you know, there's a reason that we want to be able to have that 3-month balance that we're allowed to have because things come up. The other thing is we're also carrying a significant liability when it comes to sick leave buyback for the staff. And so in a worst case scenario, if you have 4 or 5 people go out for a very long leave, you'd have to have substitutes, and that would eat into her fund balance too. So the 25 cents isn't gonna increase her fund balance significantly, but it would keep it comfortable going forward, I guess is the right way to say it. Kristen has a number of tools available to communicate a price increase to the community, whether it's on the web page or sending out letters through Backpack Network. I'm trying to think, what was the other one that you said you would do? The newsletters, so, which is how we would communicate a price increase. you have any questions.
I didn't have a question. I had just a quick comment. I read through all of this earlier today, and honestly, 25 cents, I think it's well within. I don't think that we're all very, I think, aware of increasing fees and things and taxing people more year after year, but I think this is more than reasonable and fair. And to your point, to carry us through the next 3 years, I mean, well done. You do an excellent job with, you know, I think this, I can't make my children's lunch for that price.
Thank you for that, and I appreciate, you know, when Chris and I were talking about what to recommend, you don't want to chase a dime every year,
right.
You know, which is effectively what we could do, absolutely, yeah. If that's what the committee decides that they want to do, we will do that. But this we felt was a fair, to your point, a fair price increase.
I had a quick question about, I didn't realize that the revolving fund was being used for capital maintenance. Does that allow, I know the rules of that revolving fund are very dictated by law.
Yeah, it can be used. It's used for the food service program.
Including
so.
Capital maintenance, freezers, mm-hmm. dishwashers.
Yep.
Very good. Anything else? Thank you, Ms. Seibert. And thank you so much for being here.
Oh, okay.
Do I have a motion?
Oh, yes. We should approve the increase in school lunch price in the amount of 25 cents.
Second.
Any further discussion from the committee?
Thank you for the cookies.
Thank you for the cookies. Anything from the public on this? All right, I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor? 5-0. Okay. So before we get into reports, we need to talk about Friends and Family Day, which is this Saturday, June 11th, 11 a.m. to 3, on the Birch Meadow Field Complex,
yes.
Kind of across from the YMCA and Birch Meadow School. We have decided that the school committee will have a table.
School committee is going to have a tent and a table.
Okay, and those materials already exist, the tent and the table.
It's going to be all set up.
Oh.
The DPW sets it up for
very
us.
Handy. Well, I was able to have a conversation with Mr. Robinson this evening, and I have a proposal for the committee. I'm going to be available for the full 4-hour period, so I am happy to volunteer to sit for the 4 hours. What I guess I would ask is if any of you have a free hour between 11 and 3, I'd love some company. We can certainly do it that way. We can do it here, but I also think this is a perfectly acceptable email, as long as the email is limited
yes.
to, I will be there from 11 to 12,
yes.
and then if more than one person comes, and we've got a violation of open meeting law, I will send back, please do not come at that time, we will be out of compliance. So I will handle the coordination of all of that. But at a minimum, I will be there for the 4 hours, so there will be committee coverage. But I certainly would appreciate some support. Anyone who could would take an hour. We're under 10, it'll be shaded. It's a really fun, and honestly, it's an awesome day. It's a really, really, really fun day. It'll be a great opportunity to chat with people in the public about what's going on in the schools.
I have requested that the Human Relations Advisory Committee tent be right next to the school committee tent so that I can be in two places at once. So I, too, am going to be at the Human Relations Advisory tent for the whole 4 hours, and so I'm glad to do double duty. And we will have an activity for children at our tent, if that helps as well.
It does. We'll share that too.
So I will be away. I participated last year. I will participate at the fall fair, but I will not be contributing to a quorum. I'm very sorry, but I'm away.
I could not attend last year. My daughter was in a wedding, and I made a commitment to Mr. Robinson last year that I would do the full event this year. So I remember the promise.
Thank you, because I am unavailable. I will be in Grafton, Mass. For
what about you,
three
Mr. Nye? Want to hang out?
I will be at a neighborhood get-together that's very important. But I'll try to get there maybe at the earliest session.
That would be awfully nice of you. Otherwise, it's going to be Gene Borowski's school committee yes. tent. Yeah, that's honestly, there's a lot of great stuff happening in the schools, and it is a neat opportunity to talk about. I'm amazed when I talk to people, you know, what does the school committee do? And can you fix this or that? And it's just a really good opportunity to learn about what's going on. I will do that. Is that everything you needed from us on Friends?
Because I'm not going to be there Saturday. It's my daughter's first college experience that we have to be a part of. So I'm not available.
That's exciting.
So but I just want to make sure you had everything you needed for Saturday.
We have a person who will be there. But you said the tent and people are set
that's
up.
That's going to be all set.
And is
yep.
there anyone who takes that down?
Yep.
Okay. So my presence covers
you do not need to take it down. It's
all I right. I think we're good on Friends and Family Day then. Is there anything else? on the agenda? I don't think so. Should we go into reports?
Reports.
Alex, you're almost there, right?
Yeah, we have a
10 more days or something.
10 school days, yeah.
10 school days. 6 days of finals. I have students. We're counting down at my house, too. All right, what's going on?
There's a lot of stuff, actually. Graduation was yesterday, as many of you know. Many of you were there. It was awesome. The seniors were happy and sad at the same time. And also, the symphonic band, the jazz band, and the RMHS singers contributed to the event. So it was very nice. Also, meetings for fall sports are happening throughout the high school this week, and finals begin next Thursday. There is an underclassmen awards night on Monday, the 13th at 7 p.m. in the Performing Arts Center. Also, future freshman night is next Wednesday, the 15th. The freshmen just completed Science MCAS last week. And the robotics team will have a table at Friends and Family Day. So we hope you can all go see them. And there was a chorus banquet last Friday. Everything's wrapping up.
Yeah. Mario, are you going to do a report or are you just going to?
No, I think Alex covered all of it.
Yeah.
So.
That sounds great. Well, thank you again
for
joining me.
He's taking it all.
Do any committee members have reports? Oh, Mrs.
I just would like to say that graduation, I thought, went off very well. I'm very thankful. And also just wanted to highlight that earlier in the week was the baccalaureate ceremony.
Yep.
Blessing of the graduates, which not only the Reading clergy, was beyond Reading clergy, I think. And the superintendent, Mr. Parker, Principal Parker spoke, and I think spoke very well to the students, and many of the students spoke as representatives of their churches.
Did a great job.
Did a very, was a very nice job, and the ice cream was good too. And so that is really a nice service, and I want to say that the communication to announce that was excellent. In some past years, it's been not very solid communication about the baccalaureate specifically, and that was excellent mailer. And I also wanted to comment that in terms of communication for the seniors and all the senior week activities, Allison Williams and Mr. Broken Rope implemented the text message thing, sign up and you get your text messages. And so even as a parent, you would just sort of, yep, I know what's going on.
That's great.
You know, well, that's why, where the heck's Parker? Oh, yeah, okay, so that's going on. And it just allowed the students, I think, prefer the texting as a way to keep in touch and stay on the ball. And it was really very good, and so I appreciate. And it did get on the calendars. It got everywhere. It was a little bit slow at the beginning, but it got everywhere it needed to be, so I appreciate that. And I have one other announcement, report from Chuck Robinson. His son Dan went 3-for-3 with 3 home runs out of the park, and he's going for pizza. So he will not be showing up at the last minute. So that would be Chuck's report.
Any other reports from the committee?
Thank you. I too wanted to mention how beautiful the baccalaureate service was. Very moving. Many people were brought to tears, but it was commented to me how only in America, only here, could we have all religions represented in such a wonderful, warm, spiritual celebration of our community and our youth. And I thought that was just so true. It was a beautiful, beautiful celebration. And it took a lot of collaboration and work to pull it together. So I just wanted to say that. And the St. Agnes was 3/4 full, which there were a lot
full.
Of people there.
Yeah, which was nice.
Highly recommend coming to it. I love it.
Thank you.
And then I also wanted to say the Human Relations Advisory Committee, as I said, we're going to have a booth at Friends and Family Day. Please come by with your children. We'll have an activity for them and conversation. If you have questions, we'll probably have our survey there. Tomorrow night, we have a milestone. We're going to be presenting our research thus far to the selectmen. So I believe it's tomorrow night at 8 at Town Hall. And we will be presenting our proposal that we should become a human rights commission. which would change the way we operate in town. And so we will be presenting that to the selectmen. So tune in on our CTV or come or whatever. We love people's feedback and participation. And then I also wanted to say, just I know that Mrs. Wilson will be talking about the CPAC. I just wanted to reiterate what was said before about the newsletter. It's a great opportunity to find out what's happening and for resources. And the CPAC, Special Education Parent Advisory Committee board works really hard to pull that together. And it's on the student services page on the right-hand side. So you can look there and click on the link just in case you're looking for it. And I will defer to...
Well, let's see if there's anyone else in the committee. Is that it for committee reports? All right.
So the CPAC, the plan was to meet tomorrow night. Unfortunately, there was a glitch with Town Hall, and the meeting was not posted. So we are going to have to look to reschedule, and so we'll be getting that out as soon as possible. The plan was to review the special education programs with the parents. So unfortunately, because it wasn't posted, which was kind of out of our hands. So we'll be working on that. The CPAC will also have a booth at the Friends and Family Day, so they're very excited about hosting a booth and having activity, a sensory activity for children that day. So.
Thank you, Nan.
I do have one report tonight. There'll be an information letter going out later on this week, and it'll be on our website as well, about school bus information for next year. So as with the FY16 budget, where the budget funded only the mandated transportation, so does the FY17 budget. So families will be getting that letter later on this week, communicating the fee, the user fee for FY17, which has not changed, and requiring a prepayment and then a full payment by July 31st so that we'll have visibility on what our numbers are. We do have neighborhood schools, so we have very, very low mandated busing. We could get by with one bus. So if we're gonna have the additional bus for the 7 through 12, we do need it to be funded, fully funded by parents, by user fees. There'll also be information on the website about financial assistance if families need that. And so that information will be later on this week.
A couple of weeks ago, we had a presentation about the science process that we've been going through. Actually, Joella McGinnity, who was here earlier, talked about her experiences, or the fifth grade's experience with the NOADAM program. And so although we're not completely finished with the process, I thought I'd give a quick status update on where we're at so far, because we have determined that moving forward for next year, we will be using the NOADAM program in the elementary schools, expanding to grades 3 and 4, so that next year we have that program in grades 3, 4, and 5. As Joella demonstrated last week and as we were communicating, we really feel that that program, the way it sort of promotes critical thinking skills, it presents a real inquiry-based, hands-on approach to STEM, will provide our kids at those grade levels a really strong foundation. So we're moving forward with that as we align to the state's new science and technology standards. We're still exploring options for next year at the middle level, specifically sixth grade. We've had some more meetings with the representatives from the publishers involved in that. We're getting very close though, so we're hoping to wrap it up in the next week or so. So at our next meeting, I should be able to provide a more complete update. Overall though, I just want to again say how pleased we've been with the process, with our interactions, communications with the publishers and the staffs. Their input and help has been great, and we're excited to be updating our resources and providing these opportunities to our kids for next year.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
I know we're not doing K through 2 until the following year. That's coming. Do you anticipate using NOADAM K through 5, or have you not even had that discussion?
We don't know yet. Okay. It's a possibility, but we're going to be looking at that.
Okay.
Yeah, cause we said from the beginning that K2, just the developmental stage, I mean, 3-5 was really key to us to provide certain things. So. We're looking at. We just don't know.
So is the K to 2 in the 150 over 3 years?
Yes.
Okay.
It's yes. Okay, that's so part of the 3-year plan.
Okay.
Yes.
I just wanted to make sure.
That's year 2, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I guess the only comment I would have is you'd want to make sure that there's going to be strong articulation if you decide to use a different curriculum, K to 2,
vertically,
right? Because
yeah,
it's going to be
absolutely
articulated K to 5.
Yeah.
use that program. And I still wonder, 6th and 7th grade, 8th grade, if, you know, that articulation can occur as smoothly as it were, you know, potentially using no Adam, but that's not for me to decide.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Dr. Doherty.
I have a couple items. First, I just want to compliment the high school administration and the senior class advisors. I was able to firsthand see a lot of the senior class activities over the last 10 days, and the amount of time and effort that go into the behind-the-scenes planning of those is incredible. And you know, I've had several conversations with Adam Barker over the last 2 weeks, and the work that's done by our guidance department to get some of those to students to take that last step so that they can fulfill the necessary requirements, and the amount of effort that's going into that. And there's just a lot of things that are happening behind the scenes for what you saw yesterday when 321 students received their diplomas. So I just want to give a show of appreciation for their work, because they did an amazing job over the last several weeks. I did send out an announcement to the community today concerning the principal search at Killam. And so we have 3 finalists. I've already seen each of the finalists a couple of times, and I think they're three very strong candidates. So the 3 finalists are Rebecca Gordon, who's the principal of the Ferryway School in Malden, Massachusetts. Sarah Levesque, who's a grade 3 teacher at the Bowman Elementary School in Lexington. And Lena Marie Rockwood, who's the assistant principal at the Rumney Marsh Academy in Revere. I did send out also the resumes. I believe I also sent them out to the committee. The next steps in the process is they will be visiting Killam on Thursday during the day for 2 to 3 hours. They will take a tour of the school. They will be interacting with staff. They will be getting interviewed by 4th grade students, doing a classroom observation, and being interviewed by our district leadership team during those 2 to 3 hours. And then they'll come back in the afternoon after school is over, and they'll have an open microphone session with the staff for about a half hour, and then they'll come back in the evening for an open microphone session with the community, which starts at 6:30 in the Killam cafeteria. And all community members are welcome to attend. During that entire day, I'm getting feedback from all of the different stakeholders. After Thursday, I'll make a decision whether or not I want to go visit the schools of all or some of the finalists. And then my hope is to have a decision made before the end of the school year on the 21st. So that's the plan.
That's great news.
That's it. That's all I have.
I think it's great that we got such a strong crop of candidates this late in the year. So.
Quick question. Would it be okay for a school committee member, myself, to go to the faculty open discussion, or is it, again, I won't be able to be there that evening, but I would like to.
We haven't normally had other community members attend the staff ones.
Graduation was absolutely beautiful. Your speech was very,
thank
very,
you.
Very excellent. Mr. Bacher's speech was beautiful as well. It was a very, very beautiful ceremony, and certainly a highlight of the year for everyone on this committee. Did you have anything else?
No, that was it. Thank you.
The next school committee meeting in the packet is listed as June 50th. I'm sorry, 50th. June 20th.
It should be the
27th.
It's going to be the 27th. So it's the 27th. And we do have 2 community listening forums that are organized by the selectmen but held jointly with school committee and the library board of trustees. One is tomorrow at 1 p.m. in the senior center.
Mm-hmm.
So that's Tuesday the 7th, right?
Mm-hmm.
In the senior center. So that's in the afternoon. And then the next one is a week from Thursday the 16th at 7 p.m. at Parker Middle School. So the first one, very large crowd, very productive, respectful, thoughtful conversation. So definitely people should make it out to that. Is there anything else anybody on the committee has? Do I have a motion?
Okay.
We're not doing executive session tonight, are we?
No.
No? No? Oh, that's on all of them.
move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?